morning. I told my wife I've been invited to speak at a conference in Washington, D.C., where there are at least two United States senators, at least two congressmen who will speak, an escapee from North Korea, a writer who is entirely fluent in Korean, Josh, multiple other writers who are policy experts. I said, I've been invited to speak for 10 minutes. What do you think I ought to talk about? And she said, about 7 minutes. It is indisputable that the Christians in North Korea are suffering horribly. That has been fully documented in many places, and certainly today. Not just the Christians. That atheist state is determined to wipe out Christianity, all religion. There is absolutely no compromise on their part. This is a fact, an indisputable fact, and it is written about in many places. All of you have read the articles, some written by people in this room, and I have. But recently, I made the self-wounding decision to also read the comment sections that follow some of those articles. I was devastated. It was shocking and not a little depressing. Confronted by accounts of absolute barbarism, death, rapine, torture, a few, precious few, expressed some level of sympathy, hardly amounting to the level of outrage and horror. But taken as a whole, the comments were a dispiriting trifecta of one, callousness. Why is this my problem? Why is this America's problem? Two, mind-boggling ignorance. If their country is so horrible, why don't they just leave it? Or three, a not-so-subtle schadenfreude, which arose not from racism. It was not because they were Asians, but because they were religious. The idea in that camp seemed to be that religion has caused so much suffering around the world, let the religious people now suffer alone. I was immediately reminded of a powerful line from Raoul Hilberg's. If you've not read his massive and seminal work on the Shoah, then you ought to do. But he said at one point in that, most people thought that even if the Jews shouldn't be killed, they weren't worth saving. What is, therefore, some thoughts on policy as a result of this? Not being a policy wonk or expert of any kind, I can therefore say I would like to just speak to three quick things on this. One is the issue of communication. I believe that One Great Hope is an absolute blizzard of articles. Letters to editors, letters to anyone, letters to everyone. We will probably not make a dent in the hardened soul of those who shrug at the horror of North Korea. But we can, I believe, make a dent in ignorance. The ignorant can, to some extent, be informed. When my wife and I first began working in Thailand to save children from the sex trade, we heard little, if anything, about it anywhere. Now that dirty truth is everywhere. It has been unleashed, and it is having an effect. Likewise, when the Khmer Rouge were absolutely devastating Cambodia, there was very little being said or done or written about it. But when, in 1984, that fantastic movie, The Killing Fields, Roland Joffe's movie, came out, it absolutely changed the shape of the future of the Khmer Rouge. I urge, therefore, that the creative community write screenplays, stage plays, articles, more books, do more interviews, make a scene. Certainly, those in this room are doing all of those things. And I'm just saying, this is a great work. It's an important work. Communication outside, on the outside world, is of extreme importance. The disheartening comments that I read following passionate columns about Christian suffering in North Korea and elsewhere call for one thing: more passionate columns about the suffering of Christians in North Korea and elsewhere. Second, in a recent exchange with Isaac Six, who is the brilliant young director of advocacy for this great group, ICC, a brilliance for which I am eager to take as much credit as possible since he's a former student of mine. In this exchange with Mr. Six, he suggested that one possible policy direction which resonated with me arises from the diplomatic community, and that might be that Korean ambassadors elsewhere around the world face an absolute harangue from those countries that have diplomatic relations with North Korea, Sweden and elsewhere, that North Korea's ambassadors become beleaguered, literally berated for the plight of Christians in North Korea, sort of Amish shunning. Let them feel the heat and carry it with them and communicate it with them back to Pyongyang. And third, of course, is something that everyone here has spoken about already, and that is, let China feel the heat. Perhaps our State Department, whatever direction, will respond in this new administration with a greater passion and a greater zeal to directives that have come from Congress. And that is to press China to allow at least refugees without being returned to North Korea. That's devastating. I visited in the state of Missouri some years ago a slave house which was on the free side. So that as slaves escaped from the South and Antebellum South, they were called, beckoned, come this way, come this way, this is the Underground Railroad. And when they swam ashore, or made it ashore in small boats, they were rearrested, taken to a slave house, kept there as slaves, and the women were forcibly impregnated because a woman bearing a child sold for more because it was actually two slaves instead of one, and then ferried illegally back across the river and resold in the South. I thought of that horrible, horrible little tour when I realized people who think that they have made it to some level of freedom are only met by sex trafficking and return to North Korea in a way that will at least cost them imprisonment, probably horrible torture, and even more probably death. China must be pressured to allow NGOs like ICC to do greater work with refugees, and that those refugees be allowed to stay in China and then to move elsewhere. Nothing short of some kind of Pauline epiphany will change the murderous soul of the current North Korean regime. God can change the regime, however. But if they cannot be won over, perhaps they can to some extent be worn down. I think of the Lord's parable of the widow and the unjust judge, not for the rightness of her cause, but for her importunity, she won the case. Now, take that last statement for what it's worth. It's a good example based on shaky exegesis. There is one thing which we know we must do, and many are hard about it. Many in this room are hard about it. And that is to find more and more ways to somehow, by crack and by crevice, to encourage those who suffer there. I think of the terrible risks that were run by those in occupied Nazi Europe just to crouch down in a basement or in the bottom of a closet somewhere to hear a word of truth over the radio from London or from the world. Any way that the suffering body in North Korea can hear that word of truth, that simple word of encouragement, is worth the cost. When I first began working in Ghana in West Africa in 1980, it was under the highly oppressive government of J.J. Rawlings, who fancied himself as a Maoist, called himself Chairman Rawlings. The country of Ghana now is up, it is democratic, it's doing wonderfully, but in the early 1980s, late 70s under Rawlings, things were horrible. I can remember being in the country when the pastor of the Lord is My Shepherd Church was shot dead, and then his body burned as his congregation was forced to watch, and then the military tore down their church. My own dear friend, Reverend Francis Amoco, was killed in a very suspicious automobile accident with a military vehicle. It was a horrible time in Ghana. Once I had spoken at an afternoon rally because we had to get back to where we were supposed to be before curfew, because you could be shot without questions if you were on the street after curfew. And as we hurried away from the building, the window on my side of the back seat was down, and an old lady reached in through the window and grabbed my arm with her just really claw-like bony fingers, and she spoke in Cree so fast I couldn't understand her. I have some Cree, but I couldn't understand what she said, and I turned to she just kept saying the same sentence over and over again. So I turned to Kofi Gwadu, who was next to me, and I said, "What is she saying?" And he says, "She's just saying, tell them we're here." When I was a small boy, I believe Lincoln was in the White House at that time. My father, God rest his soul, who was a tough guy. He was a paratrooper in the Second World War, and then a tank commander. He changed to armored cav between the wars, and he was a tank commander in the Korean War. And when I was in maybe the first grade, my father spent a year in Turkey working there on some kind of special assignment. When he came home with stories of a Turkish, and this same person is celebrated in different names across much of the world, from Azerbaijan even to Saudi Arabia. But in Turkey, he's called Nazareddin Hoca. He's sort of an Aesop type of character. Sometimes he is the wise person in the story, sometimes he's the dupe. One of the stories, which I'll never forget, my father translated and read to me in English. And I remember lying in the bed and hearing the story. Nasruddin, and I'll close with this. Nasruddin Hoca made a bet with a man that he could sit out in the snow all night and simply by thinking could keep himself warm. And he did that. And the man was just about ready to pay the bet off when he said, "How did you do it?" And Nasruddin Hoca said, "Well, I watched the candle inside the window of that house, and I so concentrated on the warmth of the candle that it kept me warm." And the man said, "Ah, then you cheated. You said that you would use nothing, and you used that candle." So he said, you have to pay the bet. And Nasruddin Hoca said, "Well, then rather than I give it to you in cash, how about if I prepare you a sumptuous feast? You come to my house for the feast." The man said, "I'll take it." And when he got there, there was a sumptuous feast, but it was all cold. Some of the food nearly frozen. And the man said, "This is inedible. How did you cook this?" And he said, "I cooked it by the use of a candle in the next house." Those people in North Korea must somehow know that we know they are there, and that we are more than a flickering candle in a distant window. Thank you, God.